हैं, ये बधाई का पात्र है, क्योंकि ये बहुत ही अच्छा इनिशिएटिव हमारे यूनिवर्सिटी DSI की तरफ से लिया गया है। अब मैं डॉक्टर हमारे ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर डॉक्टर रामेश्वर सिंह सर को इन्वाइट करना चाहूंगी। सर आप कृपया 2 शब्द कहें और प्रोग्राम की शुरुआत करें। सर
थैंक यू सोनिया। रेस्पेक्टेड डॉक्टर ए के श्रीवास्तव साहब, ऑल कोलीग्स, डॉक्टर चौहान, डॉक्टर राजपूत, डॉक्टर ठाकर, नागेश्वर राव, डॉक्टर प्रसाद, डॉक्टर बेनीवाल, डॉक्टर दत्ता, डॉक्टर रविंद्र कुमार, डॉक्टर के पी रमेश, ऑल एनालिस्ट्स, डॉक्टर वीर सिंह, डॉक्टर विकास जी, विजेंद्र मिश्रा फ्रॉम निफ्टेम, डी के श्रीवास्तव फ्रॉम समस्तीपुर डेरी, ठाकुर जी भी आए हैं या नहीं अभी, डी के एस एन ठाकुर, श्री नारायण ठाकुर, ऑल फैकल्टी मेंबर्स फ्रॉम NDRI, फ्रॉम बिहार एनिमल साइंसेज यूनिवर्सिटी, एंड ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट्स फ्रॉम डिफरेंट वॉक्स ऑफ लाइफ हु आर ज्वाइनिंग दिस वेबिनार। इट्स माय प्रिविलेज, डॉक्टर प्रजापति, छूट तो नहीं गया नाम, आई विल टेक दिस लिबर्टी टू बी इनफॉर्मल सो दैट वी कैन get connected because we are not meeting physically, and personal connect on the webinar is also very 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 important. So friends, at the outset I welcome you all to this webinar. You all have been very kind enough to spare your very valuable time on this second Saturday. Many of you are having holiday today and you know, working especially for this webinar. Friends, what I feel particularly is my gratitude to Dr. Srivastava, and not for only proposing this, allowing us to host this seminar, but for creating this wonderful platform, which was very much required, which was need of the hour. My memory goes back to those days when we made a very humble beginning for this academy at NDRI Karnal. We were working there with Dr. Srivastava at that time under his leadership. And he proposed that let us start the academy. And in a very small gathering of 10-15 persons, we all started the first chapter. And that's how this all began. Dr. Srivastava has taken so much interest in skills related to dairy development, and especially the academics and research, R&D, and education, dairy education. And he has almost, you know, become synonymous or a brand ambassador for dairy education and research in India. Now, at this juncture, it is our joint duty to strengthen this platform further and to make it as one of the well-known platforms which can contribute to the requirements of maybe policy matters, maybe guidance or technical issues, and any other relevant points which the forum can debate in a very thorough manner and come with discussion papers, come with different kind of, you know, background material and information, and also give directions to all stakeholders. So first thing which we are all are experiencing, that through this platform at least we all can meet from time to time and renew our linkages and do, you know, the service for our profession, which we sometimes have limitations while working in our own seats. So the academy has a special role, and it fulfills this role very ably through the esteemed fellows. So I'm thankful to the president, to the executive, for bringing National Academy of Dairy Sciences India to this position and allowing us this opportunity to host this webinar here. When we talk about Eastern India, normally we see a difference in the Western states, economy of Western India and Eastern India. We start from Punjab in most of the parameters, or we may talk about Gujarat, we may talk about Haryana, and off late, the southern states are also doing very well in economy. Since the advent of information technology and such services in the country. Earlier, a few states were named as Bimaru states, Bihar and Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan and Uttar Pradesh. But now the that symbol has changed. There's a lot of development in different states. But if we see the gross parameters, that may be GDP, that may be per capita income, that may be productivity of crops per acre of land, or that may be the productivity of animals for that matter. That may be even processing or availability of per capita, availability of different commodities. Certainly there is a gap, wide gap. We see the figures for milk production or milk processing. That's how we feel that there is a potential which is yet to be tapped. A lot of potential is available, and this potential can be realized with appropriate policy, with appropriate investment and development of infrastructure and manpower. For last few years, there has been a lot of discussion on bringing second green revolution in India. And it has been said that second green revolution will be brought only through the Eastern India. So progress in Eastern India, where the gap still exists, that can bring a big, big change. Even there's a gap of 40% in some of these points. If we see the processing capacity in an total installed capacity in the cooperative sector in Bihar and compare it with the Gujarat, then single, you know, unit of Banas Dairy or Doodh Sagar Dairy, that may outpace the entire collection of Sudha or entire processing of Sudha. So a lot of gap exists, and this gap needs to be bridged. The maximum productivity of crossbred cattle, if we take around 11, more than 11 kg in Punjab, around 9 kg per animal in Haryana, but it comes back to around 6.2 kg in Bihar. Bengal, it is still lower, and Jharkhand, it comes to around 3.5-3.8 kg. Same way for buffalo. The figures, there is a 50% gap in the productivity in these states. So, friends, what I mean to say is that this sector has enormous opportunities, but there are many challenges of infrastructure, challenges of veterinary care, challenges of, you know, different type of calamities, like we are experiencing the flood situation in 16 districts in Bihar, and 28 districts are prone to flood. So the kind of problems due to weather and due to floods and all this, that disrupts the infrastructure and the kind of processing. Further, the deficiency in extension services, that is again one issue where lot of penetration is required. I think Dr. Srivastava will cover all these points or more points in his keynote address. It is going to be, I guess, as always, it is going to be very comprehensive one, and all these points will be coming. I was just making a mention. In then some developments have taken place. The expansion capacity of Sudha is in progress. Many new plants are coming up in Bihar. Central government has taken many schemes, especially in health sector. They are now covering FMD and brucellosis in eastern states as well. National dairy plan has also been extended to these states. And under NDP, one of the biggest bull stations for frozen semen is being established at Purnia. That is 50 lakh doses of semen per year will be produced. And at the state government level, again, the shortage of veterinary doctors is being addressed. Last year, close to 500 doctors were recruited. After a long period of more than 10 years or so, otherwise many doctors were working as contract as appointments. And this year again, 600 new positions have been cleared for recruitment. So this type of initiatives, I guess, will bridge the gap in the veterinary care. But other, manpower at different levels is still remains a issue for concern. They may be stockmen or Pasudhan Sahayak or others. So all these points will be considered, and we have this region having Jharkhand, Bihar, West Bengal, and if we include Odisha. So all these states, I think Bihar is now leading, and we see the kind of example may be set by Bihar in some of these, because the growth rate and change of new policy intervention has been quite fast in Bihar. So in today's webinar, we will all discuss on this. First, we will have the keynote address by Professor A.K. Srivastava, and then we have the panel discussion. If you want to have a formal presentation, you can present, or you can give your views and the way you like it will be organized. I think I will request Dr. Srivastava to control the or to carry on the proceedings further. So friends, it is my honor and pleasure to invite Professor Srivastava for making the keynote address, and the ball will be set rolling after the keynote address because so many points will come, and we would like to have the opinion of all participants here, and a good proceeding will be brought out from today's deliberations, which we will put on the NADSI website and BASU website, and also share with state government and all stakeholders. So it's on behalf of all the participants here, I invite Dr. Srivastava Saab to make his presentation of the keynote address.
Thank you very much. Kindly share, kindly allow me to share the screen. From there, it is disabled.
Sonia,
allow me to share the screen. It is disabled from there.
सर आप कर सकते हैं शेयर।
आ गई
जस्ट गिव मी वन मिनट। Well, friends, very good afternoon to all of you. At the outset, I express my sincere thanks. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Sonia, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. At the outset, I am thankful to Dr. Rameshwar Singh for taking this responsibility.
Sir, एक उनको और बोलिए, वो हो जाएगा। जी.
Sonia, kindly mute yourself.
Oh, yes.
I request everyone to keep on mute. We can discuss later on. So, well, friends, very good afternoon to all of you. At the outset, my sincere thanks to Dr. Rameshwar Singh for sharing this responsibility to organize a seminar under umbrella of NATSI at Basu Patna. Thank you very much. And my all good friends, Dr. Chauhan, Dr. Rajput, I can see Dr. Prasad, Dr. J.K. Prasad, and Dr. Ravi Prasad, Dr. T.K. Datta, and Dr. Prajapati, Dr. Dheer Singh, Dr. Mishra, Dr. D.K. Srivastava, everyone, you know, means those who are attending, Dr. Ramesha. So thank you very much for coming in large number to attend this NATSI seminar. I think it is going to touch 100 participants. It is a very good number to attend any academy seminar or any academy discussion, brainstorming session. Program will be like this, friends, that I will be giving keynote address followed by panel discussion of the experts on their area, and then we will prepare a complete document, as Dr. Rameshwar Singh said, complete proceeding that how we can go ahead for improvement and for improving the dairy in eastern India for food and nutrition security. So my topic will be bearing in eastern India stability and fragility. Just a minute. Yeah. Well, friends, it is a very sensible statement that dairy can improve the economy of the farmers of the eastern region. The reason is that if we see the country, we are having around 147 million household, and animal husbandry and dairying is the primary source of about 100 million out of this 147 million household. If we see the 100 million, out of this 100 million, 70 million are totally dependent on dairy and their livelihood. And out of this 70 million, 75% are small, marginal, and landless milk producers with average herd size of 2 to 8 animals. This is the national average. In India, if you see, or in eastern India, if you see, in eastern India, we are having four states, as has been classified by Government of India, that is the Bihar, Jharkhand, Odisha, and West Bengal. In eastern India, about 82% dairy farmers are marginal and small, are landless. So that is more, if we improve the dairy, I think it will be more applicable to the eastern India. And in eastern India, dairying is predominantly unorganized and is dependent on rural household in this part of the country. If we talk about the stability of the Indian dairy sector, which is applicable to stability in eastern dairy sector also, it is the same. There is no doubt there is stability in dairy sector in India. Reason is that there has been a constant and sustainable growth despite very limited investment either from public sector or from private sector. And we all know that we are having the mega biodiversity, largest livestock population, highest milk production with high growth rate. I will talk all these things later on. Low production cost is still in India. It is having low production cost. We are having buffalo, best germplasm, that is the Murrah. And we know that many countries are demanding this Murrah germplasm. And in eastern India and in India in totality, all three production system we are following, that is the zero input and low output, low input, moderate output, and intensive input and high output. But 70%, 72% of our dairy is going under low input and moderate output. And that is true if in dairy sector is growing, that can be seen here also, that if we talk about the livestock output, that how much is coming from the livestock sector in totality, in total output from livestock sector, 67.22% comes only from the dairy sector, from the milk. 20.49 comes from the meat sector, and 3.1 from egg and others, means leather and all these things, that comes from 8.7. Pleasing data. If you see in 2017 and 18, the total value of output of livestock sector was this much amount at current price, and out of approximately, you can say, 67% to 68%, it came from the only milk sector, from the dairy sector. So that is the one thing. Well, friends, coming to the specifically to the eastern region, first we will see that what is the genetic resource in eastern India, in eastern India, genetic resource. For example, if I take the Bihar, 7.98% of the total crossbred cattle in India are in Bihar. 7.95% of total indigenous cattle of India are in Bihar. Similarly, 7.9% total cattle are in Bihar. 7.03% of total Indian buffalo are in Bihar. Similar picture if you see in the Jharkhand, Odisha, West Bengal, I will not read the data, but I prepared very good documents. And data of this. So this is the total animal genetic resources, which includes not only cow, but all the, male calves and all these things. So similarly, it is in Jharkhand, in Odisha, in West Bengal, we are having these genetic resources. Coming to the milch animal of total eastern region. Now, this figure gives a lot of, discussion. For example, if we see in India, I have compared with the India. In India, 47% are indigenous and 36% are buffalo and 17% are crossbred. But if you see the eastern India, 70% of total milch animal population belongs to indigenous, and majority of this group are still non-descript, not classified as a breed. 15% are buffalo in eastern India and 15% are crossbred. So this is the one reason that majority of the milch animal in eastern India, that is about 70%, are indigenous, maybe breed or maybe non-descript, very low producing and very less productive animal we can see. Otherwise, 15% of crossbred, 15% of buffalo, that can be fully explored for their potential. Second point is, eastern region is, tropically, it is a very good for buffalo. But if we see the buffalo population as compared to 36% in India of total milch animal, in eastern India, it is only 15% of the total buffalo population. This is the split up of the Bihar, Odisha, Jharkhand, and West Bengal. First figure is of the Bihar of India, and then Bihar. Bihar is okay, but see the other three states, 49% in Bihar and 47% in India, almost same. So Bihar is a success story. Bihar we keep as a success story in the dairy sector. But see the three other states, that is Jharkhand, Odisha and West Bengal, 80%, 84% animals are of nondescript or of indigenous nature. That is of the indigenous nature or of the nondescript. So that is the one issue that we will like to address, that these three states, Odisha, Jharkhand and West Bengal, still have 80 to 84% of indigenous, majority of these indigenous are of non-descript in nature. However, that has been seen, if we compare the crossbred population between 2012 and 2019 in all four states, Bihar, Jharkhand, Odisha, West Bengal, in all four states, the crossbred population has increased, barring Bihar. Bihar little bit declined. I don't know that how it happens, that it was 28.4% in 2012, total crossbred population. However, in 2019, it has come to 26.6 6%. But see the picture of Jharkhand, Odisha, West Bengal, it is increasing slightly. And in average Eastern India, certainly from 16% to 17.4%. And similar picture we get in India also, that this crossbred population is increasing. And in India, it has increased from 20.8 to 26.5%. So two issues, friends, we say that except Bihar, in Jharkhand, West Bengal and Odisha, the majority of the milch animal belongs to the indigenous, are not upgraded, and majority of these indigenous are non-descript animals. Buffalo, for which this is Eastern India, may be a good place. Their population is very less as compared to average Indian milch animal population. This diagram, you know, is very popular. This diagram, this says the success of the Indian dairy sector. The largest milk producing country in the world, we are producing around 21% of the world milk. In 2018 and 2019, the growth rate was 6.5%. And Niti Aayog says that by 2030-34, country's milk production will be touching to 330 million tons. So, in means after 13-14 years, our production will cross 330 million tons of the total milk production. Otherwise, this is the success. So today, we are producing 187.7 million tons of the milk in 2018 and 19, and we are at number one. There are a few points, which says that the there was glorious journey of dairy sector. If we see few points, India contributes almost 50% of the total global growth in milk production. In the last five decades, or in less than five decades, Indian dairy sector grew eightfold. That is very admiring. India had more milk in global pool than entire European countries. If we compare from 1970 to 2020, then in early 1970s, India's milk production was one-third of the US and one-eighth of the European countries. And today, it is twice of the US and 25% more than EU. That is the glorious journey of the dairy sector. In 2019 and 20, the milk only, the worth milk produced worth 8 lakhs crore, and which was only 6.6 lakh crores in 2018 and 19. So in 1 year, there was jump of output of the milk from 6.6 lakh crores to 8 lakhs crore. The last point, means most important, I always emphasize, but now it has been written in the Niti Aayog report, that's why I have kept in the box. And it is said that the value of only milk, the value of only milk is more than the total value of all grains, wheat, rice, all pulses put together. And this data is of 2019 and 20. So what in the beginning, Dr. D.K. Srivastava was saying that dairy sector has played major role, especially in Eastern India. This statement verifies his saying in this way. Friends, again, means today white revolution contribution surpassed the green revolution. It is established by everyone. Every fifth rupees generated in farm sector comes from the milk. So every fifth rupees we are generating in the total farm sector. And because of this, now if you see the report of Niti Aayog, Government of India has identified the dairy sector which can provide the livelihood to the millions of the farmers. So that is a very satisfying that now Government of India, Niti Aayog has said that dairy sector can be identified when it can provide livelihood to millions of the farmers. Reason is that Dr. D.K. Srivastava will agree with me that if we collect 1 lakh liter milk per day, so collection of 1 lakh liter per day from producer and supply to the consumers, during this process, we are providing employment and income to 6,000 householders. Out of that, 5,000 are farmers who are delivering about average 20 liter of the milk, and 1,000 engaged in processing, transporting and distributing. So 1 lakh liter collection of the milk is straightway providing job opportunity to at least 1,000 who are not farmers, who are not having animal, who are, but they are engaged in the transportation, processing and distributing. Friends, we all appreciate our cooperatives and all these things, because during lockdown, we will see that unlike most other items, especially food items, both producers and consumers prices of the milk and its product remained stable. And this situation was observed despite a significant fall in demand, and which was very sharp in the beginning of the lockdown. So all credit goes to the cooperatives, dairy cooperatives of this country. Now, hurriedly, we will go this four diagram, that where these four states, eastern state, stands. If we see the Bihar started the journey with 2.5 million ton of the milk in 2001. And now it is 9.82 million ton of the milk. That is a good success story. The jumping four times from 2.5 to 10 million ton in 20 years, four times jump in milk production by Bihar. So Bihar is home of approximately 7.6% of the total cattle and buffalo of India and producing 5.23% of the milk. Very similar, not very bad. It is very encouraging that 7.6% population, 5.23% on one hand, it is encouraging, satisfying. But on the other hand, we will see that what are the other opportunities where we can enhance. We are at 9th position in the country as far as milk production in Bihar is concerned. And per capita milk availability is 251 grams as compared to the national average 394 grams. But 251 grams is more than sufficient, because Medical Council of India says that Indians should consume 223 gram of the milk per day, keeping in view our diet requirement and our food habit and all this. Jharkhand started from 1.55 million ton in 2010, and it is 2.18 million ton in 2018 and 19. So Jharkhand, which is having 4.14% of total cattle and buffalo of India, is producing 1.16% of the total milk, not corresponding. The total milk contribution in national pool does not correspond to the total population in the state. Jharkhand is at 17th position in the country in milk production, and I understand Jharkhand dairy very well, because once I was observer of the dairy development of the Jharkhand state by the planning commission, and I visited a lot of rural area, villages in Jharkhand, and I have experienced with their production system. I will talk later. Per capita milk availability less than minimum recommendation of Medical Council of India, that is only 177 grams. Odisha, if we see, 1.67 million ton 20 years before, 10 years before, in 2010 and million ton. Odisha has 3.42% of the total cattle and buffalo and contribute only 1.23% in national milk pool. Per capita availability is again less than the Medical Council of India recommendation. West Bengal, 10 years before it was 4.47, and after 10 years it is a marginal increase of approximately 1 million ton, that is the 5.61 million ton. So West Bengal have 6.5% of the total cattle and buffalo population, contribute 3% only, 12th position in the milk production in the country. And again, per capita milk availability is less than the Medical Council of India recommendation. If we see, all the four states at one average, then 21.67% of cattle and buffalo population are producing 10.67% of the total milk in the national pool. And if we exclude the Bihar, then position is again worsened for the three states, that is the Jharkhand, Odisha, and West Bengal. This is the situation of the eastern India as far as their product, as far as their total number is concerned in animals, and as far as their contribution in the milk production is concerned. This slide shows, I said that I have compiled very nicely at one place so that it is on the website and anyone can see later on also. This is the per capita milk availability. I have compared from 2013-14 to 2018-19. In India, it was 307 gram per person per day. In 13-14, in 18, it is 394 gram. And now we can say very good data for the Bihar. it has jumped from 195 to 251, about 56 gram per person per day jump. It is very appreciable. Jharkhand, Odisha, West Bengal, marginal increase because there was marginal growth in the milk production. Then, which animal contributes more? Contribution of different dairy animals to total milk production of 2018 and 19. India and Eastern India, if we see, buffalo is contributing 49% in India. However, it is only 24% in Eastern India. This point has to be elaborated and has to be discussed at every platform, that why not to take the buffalo in Eastern India and enhance the milk production. 21% of indigenous contribution at national level, but 40% in Eastern India. But this contribution of indigenous animal does not match with their population. Population of indigenous animal is very high, but it is very low. But as far as their contribution is concerned, it does not match with their population. Now, challenges in the dairy sector, few points if I say, then first issue is the low productivity and high population. In India, the productivity is 1/8 of the global average, and in Eastern India, it is further low, which I will show that in Eastern India, how it is low. Then there is a shortage of feed and fodder because there is a continuous reduction in area under fodder production. And we do not see that we will get any additional hectare of land for fodder production. In Eastern India, it is more problematic because as in the opening remarks, Dr. Rameshwar Singh said that there are many districts of Bihar under flood. So in Eastern India, most part are drought-prone region, either it is Jharkhand or it is Odisha. It is a drought-prone region or flood-prone region. So again, there is a big problem to meet the gap between demand and availability of feed and fodder. Late sexual maturity of the dairy animals, large number of milch animal breedable but not calf. This point I will show, and I will show that how Eastern India is working. There is a long gap between conception and calving. There is a long gap between two calving. There is a gap between